So good afternoon once again to everyone. So in advances in manufacturing, as we all know, we have a major focus on process automation, right? And any measure that improves the efficiency of labor or to increase the productivity is to be considered as a step towards automation. Development of new products require better parts, having adequate accuracies in which in turn emphasizes the need for better manufacturing processes. And you all will agree to this. So with an invention of exotic and hard to machine materials, unconventional machining processes are in pressing needs. These unconventional machining processes, as they never employ a wage tool, which is conventionally used for the removal of material, and the energy other than mechanical energy is used for removal of material, and that is why they are called as unconventional machining processes. However, before a couple of decades, they were known as new technology, but now this technology is, we can say, relatively older. So amongst the unconventional machining processes, the type of energy that is utilized for transforming the work piece into a finished product is other than mechanical energy, or in other words, we can say that the mechanism of material removal involved is not of shear deformation, that is plastic deformation. And one such process is electrical discharge machining. And my today's talk will be confined to electrical discharge machining, and that too some advanced version of electrical discharge machining, that is orbital electrical discharge machining. So this is going to be today's talk, orbital tool actuation during electro discharge machining. And my talk will be based on the following lines. After introducing you with the subject, I'll discuss about tool actuation strategies and what do we do in planetary tool actuations. How can we carry out tool wear compensation? Because tool wear is a major problem in electrical discharge machining. Not only that, the machining accuracies like surface roughness and overcut are also to be looked into seriously. So my today's talk will be based on these lines. Towards introduction, we can always say, and we all know being mechanical engineer, that electro discharge machining process, it uses thermoelectric energy as input energy. So it is thermoelectric based unconventional machining process. And the method of material removal is of vaporization as a result of erosion that is caused because of sparking. And as far as the mechanism of material removal is concerned, as we all know, there is a workpiece and the tool. Tool is normally a cathode, workpiece is anode, which is having electrical circuit. And as a result of current that flows through the circuit, there is going to be electric field between tool and the workpiece when they are separated with a specific distance, known as a spark gap. So initially, there will be a cold emission which will accelerate the electron from cathode to anode and ions from anode to cathode. Because of the collision of the ions and electrons, it will give rise to the plasma channel, and as a result of ionization of dielectric fluid medium, and ultimately per unit time thousands of sparks will be generated, and those intensive sparking will raise the temperature of tiny minute volume of the work material at which it strike to a very high level, maybe of the order of 8000 to 10000 degrees Celsius, which is capable of vaporizing the work material. And the presence of carbon as a result of as a product of machining is the proof that material is getting vaporized. So this is the mechanism of material removal for spark erosion machining. As far as the applications are concerned, EDM mainly used for die sinking to generate complex cavity on extremely hard surface like super alloys, tool steel, tungsten carbide. It can be used to fabricate highly complicated shapes, can be used to finish sharp corners of the cavities, because conventionally you cannot have internal sharp corners of any cavity. Such radius, which is equivalent to tool radius, is inevitably left during conventional machining. But if you want these corners to be very sharp, then we need such type of operations to be performed as a secondary operation or as a finishing operation. To know more about the process, we know that every process is governed by certain parameters, which are operating parameters. And to compare the process or to evaluate the process, there are certain criteria which are required to be evaluated. And one of the most prominent criteria is material removal rate. Per unit time, what is the amount of material that is removed as a result of operation is one of the important criteria. Then, especially in electrical discharge machining, we know that tool is subjected to very heavy wear. So, ratio of material removal rate to tool wear rate is another criteria to evaluate electro discharge machining properly. And third is the accuracy of the cavity that is required. What is the finish obtained on the machined surface? What is the extra dimension of the cavity, which ultimately can be defined as overcut? That is to be evaluated and measured thoroughly. Then, with the increased depth, with repetitive sparking on the sides as well, a cavity, wall of the cavity or side of the cavity will be subjected to slight amount of taper. So, what is the amount of taper that is being created? That also should be very critically evaluated, because if you do not know or do not have any information about overcut or taper, and we select a tool exactly having dimension as that of the cavity, the ultimate result will be a cavity of larger dimension, and which will be of not any use when we are dealing with close tolerances. So some information about overcut and taper is essentially required. Not only that, the amount of wear the tool is subjected to should also be critically known. And with the technological advancement, the mankind keeps on doing some experiments or doing some tricks so that the productivity increases or process can be improved. So on the similar line, the process improvements in electrical discharge machining can be carried out by focusing on the tool workpiece kinematic or a dielectric fluid medium which separates the tool with the workpiece and which act as an insulator in normal condition. So something can be played with the type of dielectric fluid medium, or by allowing the suspended powder to be mixed with dielectric fluid medium, or we can play with the geometry of tool material. We can change the tool material, we can play with the geometry of tool material. Instead of normal use copper or graphite, can we use composite as a tool material? Can it be a sintered carbide, or can tool be cryogenically treated? Because with cryogenic treatment, normally, as we know, the hardness increases. It will be subjected to hardened cell formation on the outer surface, and because of that, tool may be subjected to lower wear, but at our end, it is yet to be experimented. Or we can have some sort of experiment with the geometry of tool. As far as the tool workpiece kinematics are concerned, either we can keep on rotating the tool or keep on rotating the workpiece. That is one of the possibilities. We can allow either workpiece or tool to vibrate so that product of machining can easily be flushed out. Or tool can be asked to orbit. See, critically speaking, normally the shape and size of the cavity that is prepared in conventional EDM, which is die sinking EDM, is replica of tool. But if we allow the tool to oscillate around its main axis using single tool, we can generate multiple cavities. So 1:1 requirement, as far as the tool is concerned, is evident in case of cavity sinking, but in case of orbiting the tool, single tool can be used to generate multiple cavities. That is number of cavities subsequently. So this is one of the target area that we have attempted. If we intend to orbit the tool, how can it be orbited? We can have this type of tactics, that is Z slicing. We'll allow the tool from the central axis up to one depth and then orbit it with some radius. Once again, depth will increase. Once again, it will be subjected to orbiting. Once again, depth will, higher depth will be machine, it will be subjected to orbiting. And this strategy is known as Z slicing. Or initially we can have a cavity sinking of the cavity which is having dimension as that of tool, and then along the entire depth the tool is subjected to be orbited around some radius. This is known as cylindrical strategy. Or we can allow the tool to undergo helical path along with orbiting. Gradually the depth will keep on increasing. This is how the tool will be gradually lowered down along with orbiting action, and this is known as helical strategy. Or we can have a radial movement of the tool. Initially a cavity is generated, tool will move in a radial fashion, it will be drawn back, oriented, will be moved radially out at some angle, then once again at another angle, and this is how radially we can orbit the tool. So these are the two important strategies which I am going to discuss today. One is helical, another is radial. So in orbital tool EDM, tool is given movement in three axes, that is X, Y and Z, as discussed with these four strategies. Smaller tool can generate larger cavity. That is what I have already explained. Materials can be removed in all axes simultaneously. Different tool paths define orbital EDM as Z slicing, cylindrical, helical or radial. And this is how we actuate the tool in case of orbital electrical discharge machining. And to carry out certain experimentation, to have a thorough parametric study, we need an experimental setup. So this was the experimental setup which we have and which has been thoroughly used for the investigation, wherein we have orbital actuation module, we have dial gauge module for measurement of X and Y axis, and then is conventional tool workpiece, tool holder wherein tool can be held, workpiece on the table can be mounted, and this is a conventional, you can say, a machining zone of electrical discharge machining. So the first will be, as we know that tool is subjected to very heavy wear in case of electrical discharge machining, and mainly it is the end wear which is creating some havoc. If we intend to machine, let us say, a cavity up to 10 mm depth, but while machining 10 mm depth, the end of the tool will be subjected to 2 mm wear. That means tool length will decrease by 2 mm. So compared to initial motion, when the machine will indicate that you have reached 10 mm, but in fact you might have reached up to 8 mm, and 2 mm is the loss on the part of tool. So to guess or to estimate the exact depth of the cavity critically, some tool wear monitoring is required to be done, and that too in planetary EDM. While machining hard materials like titanium grade 5 alloy, this work was carried out by one of our past research scholar, Dr. Vishal John Mathai, and he exhaustively carried out work during 2012 to 2016 on two-year monitoring in planetary EDM using orbital motion. So the work was initially divided into three phases. First, we decided that we don't want to go for cylindrical cavity, because ample amount of work has been reported on cylindrical cavities, but non-cylindrical cavities like square cavities, we did not find much of the work to be reported. It was underexplored area, we can say. So once we decide the type of feature that we intend to generate, then the methodology that we wanted to adopt was, we wanted to vary only one factor at a time out of operating parameters. Then for generating square cavity, it is obvious that we have to move the tool in orbital fashion in a planetary manner. But this motion can be obtained in two different ways, as a planetary motion or diagonal motion, that I'm going to explain you in the subsequent slides. And as this was the preliminary study, we never wanted to spend much by procuring the exotic or costlier material. So we decided that let us go for AISI 304 normal stainless steel using copper electrode. This was considering the economy only. So what we did, the planetary strategy which were studied, let us say this is a tool and we wanted a bigger cavity, okay? So I can actuate the tool. This is from center, let us say axis of the tool is at zero. Then I'll move the tool in a planetary motion up to 0.1. From 0.1, the tool will move to 0.2, then 0.3, then 0.4, then 0.5, then 0.6. And this is what is shown. Electrode exactly at center at 0.0, electrode moved to 0.1, moved to 0.2, moved to 0.3, moved to 0.4, moved to 0.5, and this is how, and then moved to 0.6. This is how we generate a cavity which is larger than the dimension of the tool. This is one planetary strategy. Similarly, the same cavity can be machined by moving the tool diagonally. How can we move it? From center, tool will be sent to one corner. From 0 to 1, it will be brought back to center as 2, right? From 2 to 3, it will be moved diagonally, traced back to 4, moved to 5, traced back to 6, moved to 7, traced back to 8, which is nothing but central position. So this is a diagonal strategy, which out of these two, which gives a better result, that was not known. So we studied with both the strategies initially, because these were the preliminary experiments. So we carried out experimentation using stainless steel AISI 304 as workpiece material, tool made up of copper. This is the tool dimension, and we varied all the parameters. And when we carry out the parametric variation, we are supposed to measure certain criteria for both the strategies. So we measured MRR, we have measured tool wear rate, we have measured surface roughness for all the experiments, wherein one factor at a time was varied. And then we compare it. For better comparison, what we did, the increase in material removal rate under planetary strategies, then diagonal strategy was evaluated. Similarly, tool reduction in the tool wear was also evaluated. Similarly, reduction in the surface roughness was also evaluated using these simple equations. Difference divided by MRR of planetary, because we want to compare planetary with diagonal, and converted to percentage. Fine. So using the preliminary study that we have performed, we could identify that planetary was giving a better result compared to diagonal strategy. So for identifying the range of parameters, how to, in which range we can vary the parameters, to what extent, what we did, we opted for planetary and we forgot about diagonal. So same square cavity used was, method used was, strategy used was planetary. Once again, we wanted to vary only one factor at a time, but now the workpiece is the material that we intend to investigate, titanium grade fire alloy, and tool is made up of copper. And after identifying the range, we went to carry out detailed experimentation using, for generating square feature, that is square cavity, using planetary tool actuation. But here the methodology to be adopted was Taguchi orthogonal array, because if you start varying one factor at a time, it was demanding more than 1,000 experiments to be performed. So that was not at all feasible for us. So we went for Taguchi orthogonal array and we optimized the number of experiments. But not only that, we were to carry out confirmation test 1, confirmation test 2, depending upon requirement. Then we studied mainly two parameters. One is tool actuation parameters and second, electrical parameters. Mainly the experiments were performed using copper electrode, but we tried with graphite as well. For both the tool materials as tool materials, we carried out same experimentation. So for detail, for experimentation, we used workpiece 15 by 15 by 25 mm, tool electrode 9 mm by 9 mm, 30 mm long, and offset given was 0.5 mm because we were interested in generating cavity of 10 mm by 10 mm. And these are the parameters which were varied. Apart from electrical parameters, see pulse on time, duty factor, polarity of electrode, gap voltage, pulse off time, we purposefully varied the flushing strategy as well. In flushing strategy, we tried with both the strategies, side injection, side flushing, or side suction. We studied these two strategies. For all the parameters, the levels were 4 or 3 depending upon availability, and the rest of the parameters which were kept constant. Okay, one factor at a time was done. And we preliminary conclude something. We observed that planetary is preferable compared to diagonal strategy for machining square shaped feature that was available from phase 1 preliminary experimentation. Using phase 2, we could identify that current 13 ampere is preferable, because we, as you can see, you varied the current for 4 ampere to 40 amperes. 13 ampere current is preferable, and out of both the strategies studied, side injection was giving better performance. So we opted for it. And then we went for detailed experimentation. For detailed experimentation, as we were interested in measuring surface roughness, and if we machine the cavity up to adequate depth, maybe of the order of 10 mm, then it was posing difficulty to us to carry out measurement of surface roughness at bottom. No, not only at bottom, even the measurement of surface roughness on sides were posing some difficulty. So what we did, we prepared the workpiece in split configuration. The actual work piece was parted into two pieces and we were left with two halves. Both the surface were ground, were matched, and final workpiece dimension was obtained, and we were targeting on the feature 10 mm by 10 mm cross section up to 10 mm depth, up to 10 mm depth. So this is how it is visible to you. There is a split line at the center. So these are two halves of the workpiece. So this is how it was arranged. Because after machining, you can take both the halves apart and can carry out measurement of surface roughness on the bottom as well as on the side. So for detailed experimentation layout, we wanted to vary five parameters, and every parameter was having four different values. So if you go for full factorial design, one parameter at a time, it was demanding 1024 experiments, which was beyond the scope. So we went for Taguchi approach, and we went for L16 array, wherein we had to perform 16 experiment, and then followed by confirmation test as well. So for detailed experimentation, these were the four levels of five parameters selected. Pulse on time varied from 93 microsecond to 315 microsecond. Tool path offset varied from 0.5 mm up to 2 mm. Scanning speed varied from 0.05 mm per second to 0.11 mm per second. You can very easily compare the lowest value and the highest value. Pulse off time, 335 microseconds to 550 microseconds based on the availability of the machine. Gap voltage, 40 to 85. And these experiments were performed using copper electrode. Similar experiments were repeated using graphite electrode, and then confirmation tests were also done. So based on the experimental investigation, we could see that performance of copper electrode was found to be better in comparison with graphite electrode for selected range of parameters. Pulse on time has been observed to have a significant effect on most of the responses. Responses were material removal rate, tool wear rate, surface roughness, right? And pulse on time was having the most significant effect on all these responses. Distortion on the tool electrode, surface quality of the machine surface depend upon thermophysical property of the electrode material, one. Second, electrical parameters and tool actuation parameters employed for the purpose of machining. And it is always obvious that whenever we want to produce any part or any object, our focus is to have minimum distortion, to have better quality. And that can only be obtained if we have thorough information and investigation about these three major area: thermophysical property, electrical, and tool actuation parameter, right? So using these three process parameters, electrical parameter, then geometrical parameter, and material property, thermophysical property of material like density, heat capacity, conductivity, evaporation temperature, latent heat of vaporization, all. Considering all this, we tried to develop semi-empirical model to estimate tool wear rate, amount of tool that is weared out per unit time. And we carried out dimensional analysis using Buckingham Pi theorem. And we came out with two empirical relationship, one for tool wear rate using copper electrode and tool wear rate using graphite as an electrode material. Now we wanted to check whether the relationship developed are adequately predicting the tool wear or not. So we, for adequacy check, we tried it to compare with the experimental values. These columns, they indicate predicted value, and these points which are connected with blue line, they indicate experimental values. And you can see that they are in very good agreement over the entire range of experimentation. All this experimentation, every experiment has different operating parameters obtained as a result of L16 orthogonal array using Taguchi technique. So all the considering effect of all the parameters, we are in position to predict the tool wear rate nicely using semi-empirical model. Same in case of graphite electrode, once again it is in good agreement, leaving few exceptions wherein the rate of currents were too high or too low. Then we carried out conformation test also for tool wear. Using copper electrode, using graphite electrode, we carried out this conformation test, 4-4 test for 3-3 test for each tool. Experimentally, we could find out that tool wear rate is 4.19 into 10 to the power minus 4 millimeter cube per second, whereas the semi-empirical model predicted it to be 5.22 10 to the power minus 4, and error is 14.10% is the highest, lowest minus 2.18 for graphite electrode. So for all these values, for the entire range of investigation, the error value was less than 15%. And for any semi-empirical model, the error, if it is less than 15%, we can always say that the empirical model is in good agreement, acceptable agreement. Then, as I told you, that we wanted to develop tool and wear compensation as well, because a tool wear is mainly, tool wears out mainly from the bottom surface, and the length of the tool decreases gradually as the machining proceeds. So we wanted to measure the tool wear and try to consider the tool wear rate, that is end wear. How can we compensate that end wear and to reach at the exact depth of the cavity required without any extra efforts? So what we did to measure the end wear, in normal case, when the bottom of tool touches the top of the workpiece, we say it is Z equal to 0. We used a slip gauge of 5 mm size, meaning that when Z is equal to 5, it will give us a beep. It was appropriately treated, and after carrying out the operation, once again we allowed the slip gauge to be inserted and we measured this. And it is obvious that Z value, because of the wear of the tool, it requires a tool to be lowered to a value which is less than 5 mm. And the difference in the reading, Z equal to 5, and this particular reading is nothing but end wear for the tool. And why do we need it? These four figures will give you exact insight of the requirement to carry out, to have a compensation of tool wear. See, as your operating parameter varies, the end wear vary. If your pulse off time is 335 and on time is 93, this is the level to which tool has veered. So initially, tool profile was drawn and it has been compared with the final profile. If we increase the pulse time to 315 from 93, you can see the amount of wear. Not only that, bottom is not flat, it has undergone some curved wear. For higher offset, tool is subjected to very heavy wear with higher pulse on time. And with moderate offset radius, tool is also subjected to some amount of wear. So as the orbital radius increases, you can see the amount of end wear keeps on increasing. So intensity of end wear depends upon the combination of electrical as well as tool actuation parameter. Orbital radius is changing, then pulse off time is changing, and this is how we can say that it end wear depends mainly on electrical parameter, not only independently, but combined effect is there of tool actuation strategy as well, tool actuation parameter as well. So using the experimental results about tool end wear and data about various operating parameters, we all know that normally to have a proper modeling, we normally go with a fuzzy logic technique, or we may use artificial neural network. Okay, but here we made an attempt to combine both of them, and we developed adaptive neurofuzzy inference system, which is abbreviated as ENFIS. Okay, which is a hybrid technique to have a tool wear compensation model. Both these were used using fuzzy logic toolbox available in MATLAB package. Out of the total data available, we have used 85% of the data for training, that means for training the model, and rest 15% for testing it. And for fuzzy inference system, we have used Gaussian membership functions because of its excellent prediction capability. So these are the method, this is the methodology for developing ENFIS model for end wear compensation. And this is the interface. See, all parameters were given as input parameters, and this is the end wear that has been predicted by the model. And it is obvious that somebody will make question, how can you say that what is being predicted is right? So we checked its performance. You can see these red columns, predicted value, blue dots, experimental values. For most of the cases, they are in very good agreement. How does it work? See, basically initial target depth, let us say it is D suffix T. When the machine will say that you have reached to that depth, what has happened? Tool has been subjected to this wear. Okay, obtained depth is less than that. That dA is not equal to dT. To reach to dT, you have to give some extra depth. When you give that extra depth, once again, because of the tool that is subjected to wear, this much amount is the amount by which tool has suffered end wear. So once again, if you give that depth, still your depth of the cavity is not what you want. You reached up to this level only. So you may have to give some extra. How much extra? To what extent? So you have to revise target depth, and then once again revise the target depth, and then it is a D dash T, this much total is a compensated length. To have a cavity of depth dT, you have to give this compensated length as an input, and it is to be exactly evaluated, otherwise you will come up with wrong depth of cavity being machine. This is how this end wear compensation model works. And this is the flowchart for the same. Input, process parameters, are target depth, are they in specified range? because this model works for a specified range for which it has been developed? If yes, find out this. If your target depth is greater than actual depth, yes, go. This is how it works. And this is the interface which has been developed. And this is about the validation of Anwear compensation model. For all the parameter depth that is set on the machine, this, what is the depth achieved? This much. What is the depth that is predicted? This much. And this is the error. You can see the amount of error is from 1.2 on positive side to -6.4 on the negative side. So it is accurately predicting the end wear to be given to the tool. How? The end wear of the tool is to be compensated to reach to the exact target depth. Now somebody may question that what is the use of this? If using such model, if you develop a control system and give the input as depth of the cavity required is as 10 mm. Till 10 mm depth of a cavity is achieved, the tool will keep on doing its work. Otherwise, if such model and such control system is not given, in the absence of it, tool will initially show 10 mm depth and will reach to it. But the end wear experienced by the tool will never be considered, and it becomes a trial and error method. So this type of models get us rid of such trials and error, and each time we reach to our exact target depth to be obtained. Okay, that was about end wear compensation and helical strategy. But if I want my tool to be moved in a radial fashion, then what is to be done? I want to compare it with conventional boring process and then radial tool actuation. We all know that the accuracy of the dimensional accuracy of the cavity that is being machined is of utmost importance to us. And because of the repetitive sparking, it may so happen that cross-sectional area of the cavity at the opening, at the mouth, will be slightly larger than the exact dimension of the tool. Theoretically, we can say that diameter of the cavity to be obtained is nothing but is equal to tool diameter. But because of the lower gap available, spark may occur from the side as well. And though, because of such side sparking, the dimension of the cavity is slightly larger than diameter of the tool, and which we normally refer to it as overcut. This overcut is inevitably required to be reduced to bare minimum level to achieve the accurate size of the cavity being machined. So that has been attempted using radial tool movement. So in radial tool movement, the radial orbiting tool actuates in linear path along the radius of a circle. The direction of tool movement is radially outward from the center of cavity. That means from center, it goes to the side, come back. Reorient at the interval of 5, 6, 7 degree as we think feasible. Depending upon the diameter, it will go radially in that direction, then radially in another direction. This is how it moves. The distance of tool movement from the center position is defined as orbiting radius. Initially, tool reaches to the full depth of cavity. That is, we initially perform boring operation or cavity sinking operation, and then starts radial movement. Nature of tool movement is to and fro. That means, initially it will generate a cavity which is of having diameter of as that of tool, and then when we are interested in larger cavity, we'll decide the orbital radius, but that radius will not be obtained in a single fashion. Tool will move out slightly, it will traverse back. Once again, we'll move out, it will traverse back, and ultimate destination is the desired orbital radius. Because each time we are supposed to do it cyclically, and we are supposed to give ample time for the flushing operation to take place, so that cavity of product of machining is removed, and cavity is always fresh surface is always exposed for the sparking. So tool moves to and fro. It has a forward motion and backward motion, which is controlled by machining time and flushing time respectively. Okay. The movement of tool is specified at an increment of 5 degrees from the previous path. That means in 72 movements, tool completes one circular path. So we decided to have angular increment of 5 degrees. And this is what is shown. Initial motion, central cavity is generated, then tool is moved up to one orbiting radius in one around one axis. Tool is traversed back, it rotates by 5 degrees. Similarly, as a result of that, you will get a cavity which is larger than the diameter of the tool. So here also, we use the same configuration, but here the surface cavity is not square, it is cylindrical, because initially we wanted to have boring and then wanted to move the tool radially. So for initial experimentation, we carried out on a stainless steel, and then final experimentation on Inconel 718 using electrolytic copper as a tool electrode, and we know that it is very pure copper, having 99.9% purity. So this is what is the cavity we intend to generate: 10 mm by 10 mm this way, 20 by 20 and 15 mm depth. We wanted to achieve the depth up to 10 mm. Then we wanted to, in the first phase, we wanted to select suitable strategy. Should we go for die sinking process, or should we go for helical tool movement, or should we go for radial tool movement? It was not known. So we carried out experimentation for all the strategies, and the responses studied were all this. Parameters, all this. You can see electrical parameter as well as tool actuation parameters. This is how you can see. This is boring. Initially, you gauge it and then have a larger tool to enlarge the cavity. Or this is the helical motion, wherein gradually the tool is orbiting. Along with orbiting, the depth is increasing. And this is a radial strategy. Tool moves, come back, orient itself by 5 degrees, goes, come back. And this is how this strategy will work. So for all these three strategy, cavity sinking, helical and radial, we have measured process criteria using certain operating parameters. Initial studies has revealed that 13 ampere currents give good performance or better performance. So we kept it that, and then analyzed material removal rate, tool wear rate, wear ratio for all these three strategy. For all these three strategy, you can always say that radial strategy for most of the cases have offered lower wear ratio. That means a tool has been subjected to less amount of wear per removal of unit amount of material, right? So this is something that is giving us some hope. We studied the tool wear as well. For die sinking, this is the condition of the tool. This is actual photograph after experimentation. You see the corner wear. Corners have literally weared out in a tapered fashion in die sinking. for radial, it is giving good surface. Corner wear is not appreciable. In helical movement, it is subjected to corner wear. Then we thought of having pictures from the bottom surface of the tool. This is about the side wear that we have discussed. Helical tool movement strategy, you see, this is the bottom surface of the tool, and the radius to which it is subjected is 4.09 mm. Okay, for die sinking, it is 0.6 mm on both sides. Whereas for radial movement, it is very less, 0.4, 0.5. And see the bottom surface of the tool. Tool is metallurgically not damaged. Here it has been subjected to cracking as well. You can see these images. So based on these observations, we could say that radial strategy is giving lowest wear ratio in most of the cases. Overcut observed was also lowest. Cracks did not form on the bottom of the tool. And we get a better quality of bored cavity. So we went to for the further investigation using radial tool movement. Okay, so we then started identifying the range of parameters to be investigated as a preliminary experimentation. So these are the constant parameters and these are the variable parameters. And as a result of thorough experimentation and measurement, we varied orbital radius, orbital speed, flushing time, machining time, pulse on time, and plus off time. Okay, and we could not perform the machining for spark gap more than 40 volts because it was giving some rise to some arcing phenomenon. Then we carried out phase 3, wherein the machining depth was to be identified. For different machining depth, we wanted to study the surface quality and amount of overcut. Set of experiments were performed at different machining depths, varies from 2 mm to 18 mm using one factor at a time method. These were the parameters used. So we can say that MRR increases with machining depth, whereas tool wear rate does not follow a specific trend. But however, if we compare the wear ratio at larger depth, wear ratio is low. Wear ratio is lower at higher depth, 10, 14, and 18. We measured roughness of each component. The roughness is higher for 14 mm depth and 18 mm depth. At 10 mm, 18 mm depth, 10 mm gives lower overcut. So here also, less wear ratio. This wear roughness is higher, so we went for 10, which was offering lower roughness. Here also, 10 mm depth was giving lower overcut. So we decided to carry out machining using 10 mm depth only. Then we performed detailed experimentation for machining 10 mm depth. There were 7 parameters, 3 electrical, 4 orbital, all have 3 different levels. So we went for L27 orthogonal array and carried out experimentation. The responses that we measured, material removal rate, tool wear rate, average surface roughness, and overcut. And these are the significant parameters. You can see input power, that is current, is a main significant. Then on time. and then orbital radius. Rest of the parameters are not significant. After performing experimentation and we carried out wall measurement, we tried to obtain the significant parameters for all the responses, and then we know that for overcut, peak current, that is current, pulse on time, off time, orbital speed and orbital radius were significant parameter. For surface roughness, peak current, pulse on time, off time and orbital speed was radius. Then we carried out regression analysis, okay, as a function of dependent variable, and we came out with this prediction model for overcut. You can see for overcut, these are the affecting parameters, and all those parameters are considered. Over and above that, certain actuation parameters are also considered in the equation. Here, R square value is 0.93 and lack of feet is 0.058. So once this model is developed, then we intended to validate it. So for all experiments which were performed, tool diameter, target diameter, actual diameter, overcut, target diameter is as a result of actuation. And what actually it was, the difference is the overcut. What was the predicted overcut using that model? That also we calculated. And we calculated the percentage error. Okay, the percentage error maximum is 8.62 and the average is 5.65. So we can say within the accuracy of 5 to 6%, the model was predicting overcut nicely. Similarly, for surface roughness also, for all experiments we measured surface roughness, and measurement of surface roughness at one instant was not an instantaneous measurement. It was measured 2, 3, 4 times and then averaged out. So all chances of committing errors, human errors, were eliminated. And we had a value of surface roughness, and using those value of surface roughness and saying that for surface roughness, you can see input power, on time, off time and orbital radius were significant parameters. Over and above those significant parameters, non-significant parameters were also considered. And using regression analysis, this model was developed with R square value of 0.959 and lack of feet as 0.253. And here is the validation, what has been predicted and what is experimentally obtained. The maximum error is of the order of 7.76%, whereas the average error is of 2.5%. So this basically says that the prediction model for overcut and surface roughness developed are quite satisfactorily performing. On the similar line, we developed algorithm for overcut compensation. If I want to compensate the overcut automatically and would like to reach to a exact targeted diameter, what should I do? So that this is what is done for the purpose, and the model was developed based on this. These are the experimental values obtained. This is a tool diameter. This is compensation radius. Target diameter is 11 using model, and measured diameter is 11.005. And this is the error in overcut. You can see the error in overcut is within the range of 1 to 2 micron, except one reading, wherein off time was significantly high. These are the responses obtained: MRR, TWR, average roughness, and overcut. Maximum overcut is 0.011 mm of the order of 11 micron. Okay. So this is the testing of overcut at optimum combination of parameters and its validation. So it offered the minimum overcut when measured of the order of 1 micron, maximum of the order of 0.028 mm, that is around 28 micron. Fine. So in summarizing this, we can always say that orbital tool actuation, whether helical or radial, it helps to improve the productivity and quality of process, right? Helical strategy, it helps to reduce the tool wear drastically, and wear can be reduced drastically. Radial strategies help to create accurate holes with accurate diameter, that means with minimum overcut. Soft computing techniques are helpful in managing the responses during orbital EDM process. These are the references that were used